wide bandgap semiconductors are a new technology solution for switching transistors. If you're using them in a switching application, you are looking at a possible replacement for the ubiquitous silicon. It's been used everywhere for over 100 years. Silicon works really well. What GaN does and silicon carbide provides a better switch. And the reason it's a better switch is it switches more efficiently. There's less switching losses for a given size. So the RDS on per unit area for a wide bandgap device is much lower than that for a silicon switch. And that means the transistors involved for a silicon carbide or GaN are much smaller. And the consequence of that is the small transistor has less parasitic components than the larger silicon device. And that translates into lower switching losses, which means higher efficiency. There's a very important distinction. For a switch that switches on and off once in a unit time, switching losses do not matter. It's all going to be about conduction losses. But if you have devices that are switching on and off thousands of times a second, then the switching contribution to the overall loss characteristic is very important. So if you think about it, you're multiplying the number by 10,000 if you're running at 10 kilohertz, or 150,000 if you're running at 150 kilohertz. So you can see that suddenly switching is much more important in a switching application. The obvious application would be power supplies. So a flyback converter is a very good home for wide bandgap semiconductors. Some resonant technologies might benefit from it, but pretty much anything that's a power conversion stage, which switches high voltage across a switch as part of a transformer circuit. The first place GaN was really heavily adopted was in rapid charging. And the reason was the manufacturers of rapid charge power supplies for your cell phone or your laptop computer wanted to differentiate themselves. And a key way to do that was to make a smaller, lighter power supply. Now, in order to do that, you had to have less heat sinking, less heat to get out of your design. So anything that allowed you to reduce the amount of heat in your design was a real benefit. So GaN devices came along just as this rapid charge phenomenon was emerging, and it gave an ability to increase efficiency by 1 or 2%. That doesn't sound like a lot, but it moved efficiency from maybe 94% to 96%. And that is perhaps an 8 to 10 to 12 to 16% reduction in the amount of heat you're generating. That makes a huge difference into the size of the enclosure you can put your power supply in. The other thing that's kind of interesting is GaN is much more robust than silicon. Silicon devices have an avalanche characteristic, so when you exceed their breakdown voltage, the devices start to fail. GaN devices have no avalanche. You can exceed their operating voltage by almost 50% without any long-term deterioration of a GaN transistor. You get a thing called RDS on shift, but that will recover over time. So it's much more robust. Now it's expanding into more standard appliance applications. Anything that requires slightly higher efficiency or reduced heat sinking or a smaller mass is very good. So washing machines, for example, they have lots of space, but the heat sink can be a problem with vibration. So if you can remove the heat sink, now if your washing machine vibrates, it's not going to shake the power supply. But that's very helpful. The value of GaN, and that's the thing, it's a value. It's not a cost comparison. If you look at a GaN transistor and a silicon transistor, GaN is significantly more expensive today. But its potential to bring value to the application is also higher. So the elimination of heat sinks, for example, is a dramatic reduction in system cost. You can get away from thermal compounds and potting. That also saves you the difference in the cost between the devices. So anywhere where you can leverage the benefit of the GaN in reducing that component overhead is extremely important. The interesting thing is GaN is starting to go up in voltage. We're up to 1700 volts now. And that means it's starting to do the thing to silicon carbide that silicon and GaN are tussling with. GaN is a lower cost technology than silicon carbide. It just is. The energy budget required to manufacture GaN is much lower than silicon carbide.